After having just finished a full playthrough of The Vanishing of Ethan Carter, I wanted to come back and give my thoughts about it. This is a mystery exploration game where you play as Paul Prospero, a detective that is especially talented at his job because of his special powers. He's come to Red Creek Valley because of some notes that he's received from Ethan, who has disappeared, hence the name The Vanishing of Ethan Carter. So you've come here as a detective trying to solve the case. Or, as I'm sure you'll find, solve the cases, because there's quite a bit going on in Red Creek Valley. This game is made by The Astronauts, which is a new studio that was created when the original founders of People Can Fly, who had been making games in the AAA world for quite a while, wanted to make something more personal. So they founded The Astronauts, and The Vanishing of Ethan Carter is the studio's first game. So this first section of this video is going to be very, very light on spoilers. Where I'm at right now is the very beginning of the game, so I'm going to try to show as little as reasonably possible. Of course, I have to show some things to demonstrate what I'm talking about, but yeah, it's going to be light on spoilers to begin with. But then later on, I do want to talk about some of the stuff that happened towards the end of the game. But I'll warn you beforehand, so you can just stop watching and avoid the spoilers if you don't want to hear them. So I want to talk about what this game is mostly about, what it's trying to do, what it aims for. And what that is to tell a story. Which is already a fairly exceptional thing to do in games, I think. That might sound like a strange thing to say, but the truth is most games really don't focus on telling a story. Usually they focus on having interesting gameplay mechanics, and then there's usually, of course, some sort of a story kind of tacked on top of that, but for the most part, they usually don't actually focus on the story. But in this case, this game is absolutely focused on the story. That is the main point of what it's trying to do. It has a story it wants to tell, and it tries to focus on a good way of telling that story in the format of a game, with, you know, interactivity, which is one of the key things that makes games interesting. So again, most games focus on gameplay and kind of tack story on. But this wants to tell a story, and it finds interesting mechanics that support the telling of the story. So I'm talking about gameplay and story as if they're separate things. Which, unfortunately, they very often are. Because often there's a conflict between the two. They don't really fit well together, and again, the story is just kind of tacked on. But in ideal cases, they're actually not separate things. Ideally, the story is not something that sits awkwardly alongside the gameplay, but they're actually one and the same. And yes, let's just take in this incredibly beautiful vista for a second here. Not Windows Vista, of course, that is disgusting. But no, the beautiful sun. I can practically feel its warming rays. Anyway, what was I saying? So yeah, gameplay and story should not be separate things, and in this game they are not. They are one and the same. The gameplay is to support the story, which is something that's very rare in games. I believe we're about to hear a little bit of the protagonist, Paul Prospero, talk in a second here.
Red Creek Valley seemed like a quiet, ordinary place. I've learned two things in my life. No place is truly quiet, and nowhere is really ordinary. Ethan warned me about that. Warned me not to be fooled by what I saw here. He didn't need to worry. I'd worked dozens of cases, hundreds. This would be my last one.
So, not even talking about the quality of the story itself, but just about the structure of the game. In terms of how it implements the story into the gameplay. And just in terms of that alone, it does an exceptional job. Nothing in it whatsoever feels what I would describe as gamey. So as you can see right now, there's really no UI. You know, there's no health meter, there's no mini-map or anything like that. And yeah, there is no health. You, as far as I know, you can't die. You're never really in any danger. There's no combat or anything of the sort. Really. This game is really about telling a story, and to do that, it just lets you loose and allows you to explore. So when you do explore, what do you actually find? Well, you find things like this. Let's inspect that. So you have kind of these thoughts, your detective mind getting to work. Murder, accident, blood. Ooh, crankshaft. There's crankshaft missing. Scratches, it's been used recently. And then this. So this is your power. Or at least one of your powers as a detective. You kind of have the ability to know where stuff is, to have visions. So here we go. As you see, depending on where you look, it will kind of focus your thoughts. So the thoughts of the crank are focused here, which allows me to see the crankshaft. And you can use that to figure out where it is. I don't want to get too much into it. I'll just leave it there, but you can kind of have a vision of where that thing is, and then by looking at the background and what's around it and stuff, you can go find it. So that's one of your kind of occult powers as a detective. So this is a game that has some supernatural elements, but they're fairly light. They're not too heavy. It's actually a surprisingly down-to-earth game, actually. So don't worry, it's not going to go crazy or go full-on, like, Indigo Prophecy crazy if you've ever played that game. That story just goes nuts towards the end. But this does not. So again, the structure of how it implements the gameplay into the story is beautifully done. And one of the reasons for that is actually that one of the main things that you do is basically solving crime scenes. So this is one of the first ones. Again, I'm not too worried about spoiling this because this was already kind of shown in the promotional material. So obviously something horrible has happened here. Blood trail. There's a body. I'm not going to get too much into it, but suffice to say there are various crime scenes like this one, and you can solve them. So yes, they are puzzles, but there's something unique about them. And that, unlike most puzzles, they're not progress blockers. So it's not like you have to solve this before you can continue and experience the end of the game or anything like that. No, actually, as far as I can tell, I believe all the puzzles, or at least most of them, are completely optional. I believe you can actually beat the game by just running through it and going to the place where the end happens. I think there's maybe a couple doors you'd have to open with some passcodes or something like that, but it's really light stuff. Like, for the most part, everything is really optional. And I think that's wonderful, because it kind of takes your brain out of the mode of, I need to solve this as a puzzle, right? Because it tends to happen in games, especially like adventure games would be a good example. Adventure games are typically very story-focused, and they also typically have puzzles. And very often, I find what happens when you get puzzles is, I stop thinking about the story, I stop thinking about the characters or where I am, and I just start thinking about problem solving. And that's it. Like, I need to get past this thing to make more story happen. Like, how do I get past this progress blocker? Especially if you're frustrated. That just gets even worse. But in this case, since the puzzles are optional, they're not progress blockers, and I never found myself getting into that mode of kind of like getting frustrated or thinking, I have to get past this. So everything feels very fluid and very natural. You know, if you want to know more about the story, which given that this game is focused on telling a story, then you probably would want to know more about it, then you can. But if there's something you don't want to solve, because maybe you're not interested in it or you don't know how to solve it, you don't have to. And it ends up feeling very smooth and natural. And takes away some more of that kind of gamey sort of weird feeling that you often get in games that tell stories. So that's just talking about the structure of the story, not even talking about the quality of the story. Oh, actually, before I move on to the quality of the story, I should mention that the structure of the game is actually based on what is called the four layers approach to narrative design, which is, well, as the name says, an approach to narrative design that was created between one of the main guys at The Astronauts, and also one of the main people at Frictional Games, who made the Penumbra series and Amnesia the Dark Descent, and are currently working on Soma. So it was developed between those two people, this narrative design. And I'm not going to get into it anymore, because, well, there's a paper, or not a paper, but an article that I will link to in the description by the original creators of the narrative approach that does a much better job of summing up what it's about than I could ever do. So I'll link to that in the description if you're interested in reading more about it, but suffice to say, what it means is that they have spent a lot of time thinking about how to tell a story in a game. You know, they haven't just settled for, like, let's do it in a cutscene. That's the fallback, right? That a lot of games settle for is, you know, we don't know. It's when you do a cutscene, it's basically like you're saying, I don't know how to tell a story through a game while taking advantage of the strength of a game, which is interactivity. It's basically falling back to, okay, I don't know how to do that in a game, so let's fall back to telling it how we do in movies. You know, it's essentially, a cutscene is essentially the same thing as a movie. It's a moving picture, it has sound, there's no interactivity. So it's kind of falling back on a familiar way of telling a story, but it's not a strong way to tell a story in a game. So that's the fallback. But what they've done is really think very, very deeply about how you actually tell a story in a game. How to make it interesting, how to make it feel good. And how to make it just integrated with a game. And they have done a brilliant job of that. So now to talk about the quality of the story itself, not the structure, but just the actual story. It's damn good. Again, at the beginning here with, you know, being a detective that has special powers of, like, reconstructing a crime scene, and there is some weird stuff you can find, by the way. Let me actually run back here quickly. It's gonna take me a while to get back here. But all of this might seem like it's kind of maybe a little bit ridiculous, right? I mean, I have special powers. That's already a little bit silly, maybe. There's some other stuff back here that I'll show you in a minute. However, this game is actually surprisingly down to earth. Like, as much as this stuff may seem a little bit ridiculous, having special powers and some stuff that I'm about to show you, there's actually a very, very good reason for it. Trust me, they haven't settled on this as just like a, I don't know, an easy way of kind of introducing some of the more gamey elements into a story integrated way. Like, you're a detective with special powers, so that shows you where some objects are, so that's kind of like a replacement for having quest markers and a map or something like that. It does actually work on that level, funnily enough, but they haven't just been kind of lazy in that respect. There's actually a very good reason for why you are who you are and why you can do these things, and for also what I'm about to show you. And that's that stuff like this will pop up around. So there's a weird trap here. I can use my sensibility on it. I can't quite do anything with it yet. But there's more traps around here that can maybe reveal more of the picture, and that's all I'll say about that. But there's some weird stuff that when I first played this, I thought, like, what the hell is this about? Why is there a trap? Why do I need to find more of them? Like, it just seemed kind of weird. I thought, eh. You know, I'm not sure what they're going for here. It just felt out of place. And it is out of place. But for a good reason. It's not because it's just awkwardly shoved in there and they didn't really know what they were doing. There is a very specific reason for why these things are here. And it all makes sense. So why you're here, why you have these special powers, why these kind of strange things are around here, there is a reason for all of it. And it's a surprisingly down-to-earth and touching and small story. It's actually a very personal story. You know, it's not some big thing about, like, fighting demons and killing stuff or anything like that. It's actually a very personal story just about, really mostly about Ethan and those around him, his family and friends. So let's talk about some other stuff. I've talked enough about the story. Let's talk about the graphics. I'm sure you've already noticed it's a ridiculously beautiful game. And one of the reasons for that is the fact that it uses photogrammetry. Which, if you don't know what that is, basically it's where you take a bunch of pictures of stuff in real life. And you take a bunch of pictures of it from a bunch of different angles. So, like, if you wanted a rock, you take a bunch of, you know, 30, 40, 50, I don't know how many. You take a bunch of pictures of the rock kind of like going all the way around it. And then you feed those pictures into a program that analyzes them, and from that creates a super high quality model and texture. So it recreates basically the object that you took a picture of. And that is probably the main reason why this game looks so ridiculously beautiful. Because most of this stuff is actually assembled from real world things. And as such, the fidelity is amazing. And just the texture of everything. Like, everything feels so worn and used because it actually was. Because these are actual real-world things. And you can see when I zoom in here, the level of detail in the textures and the models is really extraordinary. I mean, everything, even the freaking boards on the ground look beautiful. Amazing vistas, water and trees, leaves blowing in the wind. And this game was actually made by a very small team. They did not have many people. So it's a level of fidelity, and the art direction is exceptional, and it's all so good to a degree that I could never possibly expect anything like this from such a small studio. It's really amazing what they've accomplished. And that's not to say that the use of photogrammetry took all the effort out of making the graphics. It's not like you just take a couple pictures of something and then, you know, everything looks amazing. It's not that simple. It's actually apparently very hard to do photogrammetry. And even just the taking of the pictures themselves is apparently a big challenge to make it work. God, look at how good everything looks. It's amazing. So yeah, basically a bunch of, well, maybe not a bunch because there's really not that many people working on it, but some very talented people used some very awesome technology, and this is the result. Incredible graphics. I mean, this is seriously one of the best looking games I've ever seen in my entire life, ever. In my entire life. And it's a small game made by a small studio. I would expect this sort of a thing from a AAA studio, not from a small studio, so it really is amazing what they've accomplished. And again, it just looks ridiculously beautiful. Also, another thing that's great about it is the music. Ooh, I even know something I can do right now to demonstrate the music, but it would kind of spoil the game a little bit. I don't want to do it. Suffice to say that, you know, right now there's kind of some general background music going on, which sounds nice, but the music really comes into full force during certain sections. Like, all the time when you're inspecting crime scenes and you get to certain places, there are specific songs that will play that are unique to that and really capture the feeling and are just incredible. It's really got some incredible music. Alright, so I've talked about all the things I really like. Let's mention some of the things that I did not, which are very, very few. I have almost nothing to complain about with this game. But I will say, despite how good everything looks in terms of the environment, I think one of the weak points are the people. My only example for a person is this person with their legs chopped off. Ugh. Let's not look at that. But yeah, the environments look incredible, but I feel like the people don't look as good. They don't look bad, don't get me wrong. I think it's just the fact that when your environments look so ridiculously good, anything that does not look as ridiculously good really stands out like a sore thumb. And the people definitely do. They look kinda weird. They look a little bit weird. The way they move, and they seem kinda lumpy and stiff. I don't know, they just don't look great. They're okay, but they stick out a little bit. The other thing I would mention is that there is one section of the game that really just didn't work for me. I don't want to spoil it, so I won't go into specifics, but basically it's a section where you have to collect a bunch of things, and after you collect these things, they allow you to figure out the password to something. So you can think about them like fragments of a note, for example. They aren't actually fragments of a note, but like collecting fragments of a note to figure out a password, basically. So you have to collect them, and then you have to figure it out after collecting them. And that whole section didn't work for me very well. Not because the figuring out of the password was hard. Actually, the figuring out of the password, once you have all of the pieces in place, it was actually very good. It felt very satisfying, it was really well done. But the actual collection of all of these different pieces was a little bit annoying, because you're basically kind of like running or walking around what is essentially a maze-like place, looking for all of these different pieces so that you can finally figure out what the passcode should be. And that felt a little bit gamey and kind of like a waste of time, going around finding all these different pieces. Like, the solving of the puzzle itself felt good, the finding of the pieces, not so much. But that was just one section, it wasn't a big deal. Very minor thing. And I feel like a reason for that might be that that whole section is supposed to be, at least I think, is supposed to be scary. But I really didn't find it scary at all, so, you know, maybe going around this maze looking for these different parts would feel different if I actually was scared. Maybe it'd be a tense, nail-biting affair. But for me, it was just kind of like, oh, I gotta run through this thing, find some things, and yeah, whatever. But not that big of a deal. And another thing I want to mention is that this game is short and sweet. It took me about 5 hours to beat. Actually, nah, you know, I actually don't like using the word beat. Beating a game. I don't like it, actually. I want to say it took me 5 hours to finish. That sounds better. I think when you say beat, it, I don't know, it kind of feels like it has a connotation of the point of the game is to get to the end, but I feel like the point of a game is more to kind of experience everything, you know, as a whole, rather than just getting to the end and rushing to it. So yeah, it took me about 5 hours to get through the whole thing, which is relatively short for a game, and I think that is freaking wonderful, because frankly, I think games are generally way too damn long. They often do really cool things, but then they do them like 200 times and then they become not cool things, which is really unfortunate. But yeah, this one is short and sweet. So it took me about 5 hours to complete. And for a story-focused game, I think it's especially important not to have any padding whatsoever. You could really just focus on the story. I think any padding that you'd add to it really would feel... Well, obviously it'd feel like a waste of time, since by definition padding is a waste of time. So yeah, short and sweet. It is a perfect example of quality over quantity. It's incredibly dense. There's stuff all over the place, it's incredibly beautiful things to find. And it doesn't waste your time for a minute, really. Other than perhaps a little bit in that one section where I mentioned where you have to collect a bunch of stuff. But again, that's actually entirely optional, you don't actually have to do it, so, you know, it's not really that big of a deal. So, short and sweet and wonderful. So I think that pretty much sums up my thoughts about this game, as far as the non-spoiler section goes. I will say, if you intend to play this game, which I would highly recommend, it is wonderful, it's one of the best games I've ever played, then one tip that I would have is, I want to explain the save system, because I didn't quite understand how the save system worked when I first played, and it annoyed me a little bit, because it's kind of weird. So basically, the game is divided into scenes, which are basically like the crime scenes, like the body up there, that is a scene. And all the stuff that kind of happened around it is part of the scene. So it's kind of like a distinct area where distinct events happened. And the way the save system works, at least at the moment, assuming they don't patch it and change it, is that it only saves scenes if you complete them. So what this means is that if you, say, pick up some of the objects and maybe move some things around, like you get through partially completing one scene, and then you move on to another scene, and finish the other scene, so the first one is only partially complete, the second one is completely complete. When you complete the second scene, it'll save that scene. But that scene only, it won't save the partially complete previous scene. So in other words, if you don't fully complete a scene, it won't save it. So if you pick up some objects in a place, but don't complete it, and then you load your game, those objects are going to be placed back on the ground and everything's going to be exactly how it was when you first got there. So that annoyed me a little bit when I had done that, when I partially completed a scene, came back and was confused. I'm like, I thought I picked this up, like, what the hell? That was very strange, but yeah, that's how it works. So I would definitely recommend completing a scene before you move on. Not that big of a deal, but just a little thing that's nice to know. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the spoiler stuff in a minute, but assuming you're leaving me here, then I just want to say that you can grab The Vanishing of Ethan Carter from Steam and GOG, and I'll have links to that stuff in the description. Okay, so major spoilers coming on right now. If you don't want to be spoiled, then go away. I'm assuming you're not listening, so I'm just going to say it like 10 more times. Major spoilers, close if you do not want spoilers. Major spoilers! Are you still here? Spoilers! Okay, so let's talk about some of the things that happened in the game, in the story, and especially the end. So I got the main gist of the story. Like, I got basically what happened. You know, you get to the end and you find out that Ethan basically made you up. That Paul Prospero is not real. It's, you are playing a fictional creation of his that he made while he was unconscious and dying from smoke inhalation in the Vandergriff Mansion, I believe that building was. So basically the entire game takes place as he's drifting off to sleep. Drifting off to death. And I was looking on the Steam forums for other people's interpretations of the story, see if there's anything I missed. And I haven't looked super extensively, but there's some interesting things I found that I hadn't thought of. And as far as I can tell, the basic structure of the story is correct. You know, that is what happened. You are a creation of Ethan's mind as he's dying. But there is some pretty cool stuff that some people mentioned and picked up on that I did not. And one is that the reason for all of these stories, well, I'll just say, like, all of these stories that you see around here, all of these murders, you know, of his family members killing each other and whatnot, they obviously weren't, they weren't real. As you can see at the end, you know, they're just his own creations. However, what I didn't consider is that the reason for why that is, like, why did he decide to make a story about his family murdering each other, and coming after him and, you know, trying to hurt him, and being controlled by some evil being? And as somebody pointed out, the reason for this is because he was trying to come up with a justification for why his family would treat him so poorly. And what I mean about his family treating him poorly is all the snippets we heard throughout the entire game of how basically dismissive they were of him. You know, he tries to tell stories, give stories to his family members, to Ed and whatnot, and all of those around him, and they always just say, like, yeah, whatever, you know, I'll put it aside, read it some other time. They really don't care about what he's doing. You know, he loves stories. He loves to write stories. He obviously loves to read books. They mean a lot to him, but his family just doesn't care. His family just really doesn't care about him that much. And, I mean, you can especially see this coming to its kind of, this whole disrespect of him coming to a head at the very end of the game when the fires first started. When, what was his name? The cousin and Travis's brother as well. Didn't they both call him a faggot, basically? they just outright called him a faggot, just for, you know, being someone who's imaginative and likes to draw and make stories and stuff. Like, he was treated very poorly by his family, by those around him. So it absolutely makes sense that he created a story to come up with to basically rationalize why these people that should love him, and, you know, maybe they did love him in some way, but why these people that should treat him well were not. He was trying to rationalize it. You know, why are these people that are supposed to be my family, why are they treating me so poorly? So he came up with a story that they're being controlled by some evil force, right? It's easier and less painful to think that your family are being controlled by some evil force making them do that, rather than to think they're actually just not very good people to you. So that was a kind of, I guess, bittersweet discovery, because, yeah, that absolutely makes sense, and it's very sad. Another thing some people mentioned is that the sleeper, and it keeps mentioning the sleeper, is actually Ethan himself. I never really thought about that, but that absolutely makes sense. They keep talking about the sleeper, and, well, at the end of the game, Ethan is sleeping. Or drifting off to sleep. They talk about waking the sleeper. And yeah, I'm pretty sure they are actually talking about Ethan himself. Drifting off to sleep. And of course in the story, they never actually awake the sleeper, do they? And in the actual story, in reality, in what actually happened to Ethan, at least as far as we can tell, it seems that Ethan, well, did not wake up. There's almost no way he actually survived that. Also, another interesting thing, which is the reason why I came here to look at this clock, is times. So if you remember, I might edit in a little clip here. Actually, yeah, let me do that. There. I just made a note to myself to edit in a clip here of the very end of the game where you see him drifting off to sleep. You see him going unconscious. And it shows the clock and it says 7 o'clock. So if you ever needed a little bit more evidence that everything that is happening is actually taking place within Ethan's mind, then this would be it. So we know that he started drifting off in unconsciousness at about 7 o'clock, and it would seem that he created all of this in his mind while he was going unconscious. And, what do you know, when you look at this clock here, it's 7 o'clock. Time is frozen. And I believe if you look at the one on the other side, yeah, this one is at 704. Which I'm going to edit in a clip here as well of when they show him a little bit later. I believe that's when he died. I think the clock says 704 or something very close to that. So yeah, he started going unconscious about 7 o'clock, and he, I guess, died at about 7:04. And this entire game took place in about those 4 minutes. Which is really freaking sad, actually. And now listening to this music play while thinking about it is making me even sadder. So yeah, that's what I meant about the deeply personal story that I didn't want to spoil for anyone who has not played the game yet. Because at its surface, it might seem a little bit fantastical. You have the ability to see where objects are, and you know, there's all this talk about a sleeper and awakening, kind of an ancient evil and all that stuff. But you know, in reality, it's just a story about a little boy in a small town who just likes stories and I guess isn't normal to those around him. And how he deals with that, and then finally his demise. God damn, it's a really good game. It's really, really good. You know, at the beginning, I feel like if you don't... Like, I didn't quite trust the developers at the beginning. In the sense that some of the stuff that was happening, I didn't believe. Like, the stuff with the traps, I thought that was a little bit weird. Like, why are these traps here? They just kind of seem silly. But, you know, by the end of it, now I realize that every single damn thing that happens in this game is really for a damn good reason. Like, they really thought it through. They didn't just throw in stuff into the pot, you know, hoping the soup would turn out well, if I want to keep going with this analogy. No, they carefully selected every single ingredient, and they knew exactly what they were doing. So, there you go. That is The Vanishing of Ethan Carter.